Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 12 through 17, and continues with verses 26 and 27. Hear now the word of God. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
When you see Griselda this week, our associate pastor, I want you to pat her on the back. And in the meantime, I want you to be in prayer for her. Griselda conducted her second funeral ever on Tuesday. I don't know if you remember, but last week we prayed for a 30-year-old DACA man who had been in the final stages of ALS, and he died prior Friday. His sister had come to the church, and that morning when I had come in, his sister was sitting in front of Nalene's desk weeping, and Nalene had that deer in the headlights look and was going, Griselda's coming, Griselda's coming. Because the two of them did not speak the same language. So Griselda came and worked with this sister. Turned out that the man had 10 brothers and sisters. Two of whom were in Mexico and could not come for the service. So this sister and Griselda worked out a service. And we helped out because we used the chapel for the service of this man. Now, the theory was that visitation was going to be from 10 to noon, and then the service would be from noon to 1, and then they could all load up and get to the cemetery about 1:30 or so. And that was the operating view. By 10:15, the chapel was just about full. And there was lots of conversation going on. At 10:25, the mariachi band showed up. Now, it turns out that mariachi bands do not play pointing towards the congregation. They play pointing towards the casket, which in the chapel meant they were aiming at the wall that separates the chapel from the office. And it did a very poor job of separating the chapel from the office, because mariachi bands know how to do volume. And that volume went right through the wall, and Nalene heard it and left early for lunch because she had a headache. I was out, you know, I don't know enough Spanish to be useful, so my whole job was to be the chief usher, because I can say bienvenidos and open the door. And about halfway through all of this, I also became the usher that went in and went, can you scoot down a little so that we can get more people in the seats? Well, Sylvia Dean was the funeral director, and so she and I are out in the lobby, and those glass doors did nothing to hold back that mariachi sound. Turned out the mariachi was also a cue for the mother and for another woman who turned out to be a member of the family to begin wailing. And I do mean to wail. They also managed to penetrate that back wall. All you can hear them back in the office. Draped over the casket. And I was sitting out in the foyer thinking, wow, I'm really getting an education about funerals. I've done 28 years with funerals. I never had one like this. And by the way, it's far more entertaining than I'm going to tell you right now. If you want the full story, you call me sometime next week. I'll tell you the whole story. But there were these women who were wailing, draped over this open casket. And when I began wrestling with the Romans passage, it occurred to me that maybe they are onto something. Of course, weeping and wailing is biblical in the first place. There's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with wailing. There's nothing wrong with crying. Certainly a funeral is the appropriate place to do it. So maybe they were onto something. I started studying this passage before the funeral on Tuesday, and it occurred to me that maybe this passage was onto something because of how I've been behaving for about the last, 6 weeks or so. When the Sutherland Springs mass shooting occurred, you know, I drummed up some prayer words, and I put the prayer words on Facebook, and we gathered here and we had prayer. But I do remember that when the Parkland shooting happened, that when I got that news, my first reaction was, "Dear God Almighty." And I was not being pious, nor was I taking the Lord's name in vain. Dear God Almighty. I'm not sure that's praying as I ought to pray. Which is okay, because as it turns out, Paul says, I'm covered. I don't know how to pray as I ought to pray. None of us do. None of us know how to pray as we ought to pray. So I suppose, dear God Almighty, is this good a way to pray? When I got the news of the Santa Fe mass shooting, I ran out of words. And my first reaction, do you remember the cartoon Peanuts when Charlie Brown would always try to kick that football and Lucy always jerked it out of the way? And the next panel always showed Charlie Brown sailing through the air screaming, "Ah!" You remember those? That's what I did when I heard that. I sort of, "Ah!" And I've run out of words. I've run out of words of what I'm supposed to say in that situation. I've run out of words what to say to the Bernards. Woody's death was bad enough around here. And for parents to lose a second child, there are no words for that. Now, maybe some of you who raise children might understand this, but it's been my observation that if you raise children, you have to keep after them for some fairly simple things. Okay? No, you have to put your dirty clothes in the dirty clothes hamper. Okay? And it turns out, you have to say that more than once. No, you have to put wet towels on the towel rack. And you have to say that more than, am I right about this parenting stuff? I'm just watching you guys try to parent people. You know, they come to the table. You need to go wash your hands. No, you wash your hands for every meal, not just the last one. Go wash your hands. And inevitably, the child comes to the table, and you say, did you wash your hands? And they go, no. Now, this is where my observation needs to check. Because my observation has been that sometimes, have you washed your hands? No. Some of you go like this. Okay, I'm thinking this is vaguely familiar to some people. Yeah. And when I read this passage of scripture, that's the image that pops into my head. We do not know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit intercedes with us with sighs. And I'm not sure that those sighs are just lovely deep breathing. I'm thinking that sometimes those are sighs of exasperation. That sometimes when we start praying and our prayers don't go anywhere, that the Spirit intercedes for us, but the Spirit is exasperated as we are. And the next phrase it says, and the Spirit groans. And isn't it interesting, because at least in this passage from Romans, the Spirit is not using words. So maybe those women who are wailing at the funeral are on to something. Maybe when the funeral is so deep and so painful, there aren't any words. There's just wailing and weeping. And maybe when the next, God forbid, when the next mass shooting comes along, the only thing we're going to be able to do is, dear God Almighty, to calm down God. The worst problem always is God looks at us and says, okay, I'm frustrated too. What are you going to do about it? And sometimes we even run out of the exasperated words and we're so frustrated. And what Paul says is that our spirit joins with the Holy Spirit in those occasions. We've been adopted. The Spirit has adopted us. And the Spirit witnesses with our spirits. And then when our spirits don't have any words to pray anymore, we do not know how to pray as we ought to, then the Spirit intercedes with sighs and with groans, because maybe even the spirits run out of words. Now, do not get me wrong. I am not advocating that we don't pray the Lord's Prayer every week. We're going to pray the Lord's Prayer every week out loud. And don't get me wrong. I'm going to go right on using words for the pastoral prayer to try and express what's going on in the community. And sometimes it's not going to work, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. And the problem is at least 2,000 years old. John's disciples said to him, teach us how to pray. Jesus' disciples said to him, teach us how to pray like John's disciples did. And we still keep learning how to pray. And Paul, maybe Paul did that exact same thing. We do not know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit intercedes. God's Spirit intercedes with us with sighs, sometimes in exasperation, I suspect, but with sighs too deep for words, with groans, and with wailing, and with tears. It's not an excuse not to pray. We've got to keep praying. But we may not always have to use words. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.